Well, you're very welcome along to another edition of the Irish Connection Country Show. And on today's show, as always, we've got a very packed show. A little bit later on, we're going to be meeting and greeting the true ambassador of country music from Nashville, Tennessee, George Hamilton IV. We're also going to be getting up close and personal and meeting a gentleman who is probably one of Ireland's premier songwriters. That is Walter Cunningham from Mill Isle, County Down. But my first very special guest on the show today is a gentleman that comes from Armagh. He's a member of a band called Live Issue, and that's Colin Elliott. Colin, you're very welcome along to the show.
John, it's wonderful to be here. Thank you very much.
Lovely to have you along.
It's good to be here.
And listen, tell us a little bit about Live Issue for the people that don't know a lot about the band. I mean, explain how they came into being.
Well, Live Issue is a country gospel band. We've been together now since we reformed in 2006, so about 4 years. Previous to that, we grew up together. And three of the members, Roy Drenning, Sam Armstrong, and myself, we started off when we were about 16 or 17 years of age, and played around all the little meetings and concerts around Northern Ireland, down in the Republic of Ireland too. And we got together when Roy Drenning turned 40. We got together again for a surprise birthday party. And from then, the thing just took off. We've been to Nashville. We do regular concerts and conventions all over England and Scotland. And we're just kept really, really busy, and we love it.
Mm. I mean, how did you decide on what musical direction Live Issue were going to take when you were first becoming a band?
I think we grew up listening to country music. I think there always was that influence. And because we sort of live in a country area as well, and people that we knew were into the country music, our parents enjoyed the music. I mean, my father was a big fan of George Hamilton IV, and we used to get his records and the old 8-track cartridges in and listen to him. So there was always that influence. And I guess we've put our, you know, Irish spin on that as well.
And who were some of the major influences for the band? You mentioned one, which is going to be one of our guests a little bit later on the show, George Hamilton IV. Who other artists gave you inspiration and sort of helped to, you know, conjure up what is now known as Live Issue?
Well, there's a real melting pot because we all have different influences. Johnny Cash was a big influence, and of course, George Hamilton IV. But also, you know, there's an element of the Beatles in there as well. You know, we like them. So there is that sort of rockabilly stroke country influence. And we just love good up-and-going country gospel music. I mean, it's a ministry for us as much as the music. But we feel that it's a music that touches people. It's for people. It's from the soul. It's country music.
Mm-hmm. I mean, how do you lot get on? Do you get on really well together? Do you ever have any major fallouts about what you're going to record or what you're going to sort of do in a concert stroke show?
No, we don't. No, we get on really, really well together. I think because we've grown up together, we're almost like brothers, and probably closer than some brothers would be.
I mean, how did you get the vocal harmonies as tight as they are?
Just really work and practice. So, I mean, there's no other way to put it. But again, the fact that we've known each other for so many years, it gets to the stage, Sean, where you know what someone else is going to do musically whenever they're singing, or if somebody does make a mistake, and perish the thought, but if somebody makes a mistake, you know how they're going to get out of that mistake, and we can all follow. So it's like a good marriage. You get to know each other really well.
Okay, tell us a little bit about your new album, which we've got here, called The Long Road. I mean, tell us how that all happened for you.
Well, that is an album, a solo project, which I put together last year, as just prior to an American tour that I was doing. It was a solo tour, and for part of that tour, I linked up with George Hamilton IV. So it's some songs that I recorded myself, some songs from Live Issue that were my favourites, and also some duets with George. And it was very well received in the States and back home here. So I'm quite pleased with it.
And where was it recorded? Back here in Northern Ireland or abroad?
Yes, I've always loved recording. And I've a little studio at home and called Hillcrest Recordings. And I would produce George Hamilton and Live Issue and myself. And it just is, it's a project that whenever you have your own recording studio, you can go, you can work on it when the time suits you, and of course you're not paying those studio fees, But of course, there is a problem because you're never quite satisfied with what you produce, and you're always going back and trying to tweak it and change it. Mm-hmm. But it's a good album.
But of course, you have another job as well, don't you?
Yeah, I'm a school principal, a primary school principal. I'm principal of a school called Brownlee Primary School in the centre of Lisburn. And it's a little school, about 170 pupils, and very hard-working staff, lovely children. And I've been there 11 years, Sean. And it's such a change from the music business, so to speak. But it's a very important part of my life.
How does the kids react knowing that you do recordings and you're a performing artist as well as a teacher?
Well, I've tried to keep the two separate, if possible, but sometimes they collide. And last year, the BBC came in and did a television interview prior to us going off to sing on the Grand Ole Opry. And they came and did an interview and did a live performance in front of the kids. So they enjoyed it, and they think it's interesting, and they see me maybe in the newspapers or hear me on radio, and I think they've become used to it.
Because it's one of those things. You see, Charlie Lansbury had the same idea. He was a teacher, then he became a singer. Stinger, the Police, had the same thing, you know. So it's very common in the music business at the moment, you know. Yes. Teachers becoming, I mean, do you feel like from being a teacher and being a performer, you still have to work at getting your message across to different genres of people?
Absolutely. It's similar. If you're at the front of a classroom, you're still performing. And you still have got to do the preparation. And whenever you're singing, you know, people see you singing for maybe, you know, half an hour or a 2 hour concert. That's a very small part. It's all the preparation that goes into that, just like teaching.
Mm-hmm, that's it. Now, also, you're involved in another new album, which, as I said, is from one of our other guests, which is George Hamilton IV. Now, you actually produced the new album by him. Tell us a little bit about that.
I had produced a couple of albums for George in the past, and George approached me and we discussed this project. And the album was called Old-Fashioned Hymns and Songs for Those Who Miss Them. And we'd been talking about a lot of the old hymns and gospel songs that you don't hear so often now. And the project grew from being an album of old hymns to being a duets album. And we ended up, we had Marty Stewart and Ricky Skaggs and Pat Boone and George Beverly Shea, the great gospel singer, on it as well. And Bill Anderson from the Opry, Connie Smith. It just became a list of who's who. And I produced that both here in Northern Ireland and also in America. And we worked with a studio called Le Mans Records in Nashville. And a lot of the artists recorded their vocals over there, and then they were sent to me. And Live Issue and myself, we did all the backing music and basically put the whole thing together. George did his vocals with me. Tommy Cash, Joanne and Johnny Cash's brother, he came to my home. We had lunch one day and then went out and recorded the vocals. So it was a very, very good time. It's something I'll cherish, the whole production process. From start to finish, it took almost 3 years because we had to work out keys with all the different artists. And then we had to work out George's keys for the songs. And then some of the artists said, look, would it be possible to record this song or that song? Maybe a song that meant a lot to them. But it was a wonderful project. And to work with Charlie Pride and Marty Stewart and Ricky Skaggs, those guys were lovely to work with. And even though I just owned a small studio in Northern Ireland, they treated me with the same respect. And then we went over to release it back in July at the Grand Ole Opry. And at the Midnight Jamboree, immediately after the Opry show, we had a bit of a ceilidh, for want of a better word, where we got as many of the artists as possible together. And we had this very informal concert. And Dave McCormick, who runs the Midnight Jamboree in Nashville, said it just reminded him of the old days. With Ernest Tubb and, you know, all those guys from the 50s and 60s. And George pulled it off very, very well. It was good.
Right. Thanks a million, Colin, for being one of my guests here on the Irish Connection Country Show. And I believe we're now going to hear some music from you. So now, folks, here is Colin Elliott, who you just heard me talking to you, singing live here on the Irish Connection Country Show.
A banker and the preacher, riding on a midnight bus bound for Mexico. One was heading for vacation, one for higher education, and two of them were searching for lost souls. But that driver never ever saw the stop sign. And 18-wheelers can't stop on a dime. There are three wooden crosses on the right side of the highway. Why there's not four of them, heaven only knows. I guess it's not what you take when you leave this world behind you. It's what you leave behind you when you go. Well, that farmer left a harvest and a home of 80 acres, the faith and love for growing things in his young son's heart. And that teacher left her wisdom in the minds of lots of children as she tried to give them all a better start. And that preacher whispered, "Can't you see the promised land?" as he laid that blood-stained Bible in that hooker's hand. There are three wooden crosses on the right side of the highway. Why there's not four of them, heaven only knows. I guess it's not what you take when you leave this world behind you. It's what you leave behind you when you go. That's the story that our preacher told last Sunday, as he held that blood-stained Bible up for all of us to see. He said, "Bless the farmer and the teacher and that preacher who gave this Bible to my mama, who read it to me." There are crosses on the right side of the highway. Why there's not four of them? Well, now I guess we know. It's not what you take when you leave this world behind you. It's what you leave behind you when you go. And there are three wooden crosses on the right side of the highway.